The Disappearance of Joanne Williams Part 2. On Friday, December 15, Joanne Sred Dotson was found 2 miles from her home on the wrong side of Everett Avenue near the intersection with Lafayette Street. Newspaper accounts claim that the car was found by either a family friend or by William Williams himself. It was unlocked, and the keys were nowhere to be found. This was concerning to all involved as Joanne had no known friends in, or connections to the area, which was widely reported as rough or sketchy. Joanne's purse, containing money, her eyeglasses, a set of contact lenses, and the case for the contacts she'd been wearing, was found behind the driver's seat. Autry would later tell reporters that Joanne would always put her purse behind her driver's seat when in her car. It wasn't unusual for it to be there in normal circumstances, but under these circumstances, it adds an entirely new battery of questions. Elsewhere in her car were her bank books, a checkbook, an uncashed check, over a dozen cassette tapes, as well as a tape deck still in the dash. There are conflicting reports as to a pair of brown gloves Joanne had left her house wearing. Some articles claim the gloves were found draped over the shifter, while others claim they were never found and include the gloves in the description of what she was last known to be wearing. Gloves or not, the discovery of Joanne's car brought her disappearance into a stark new light. Police were able to determine only a few pints of gasoline had been consumed since Joanne filled up her tank after finishing work on the 7th, and the car had likely only been driven 2 to 3 miles afterward. Because of this and other evidence, police believe Joanne's car had been parked along Everett Avenue for days, possibly since the night of the disappearance. However, Audrey and others have difficulty accepting this. There were plenty of items in the car that could have been easily stolen, and often caught the eye of thieves. If Joanne's car had been abandoned and unlocked for as long as a week in this area, it seems odd that the valuables within wouldn't have been stolen. William Williams reached out to the media for help, and the news shone a light on the strangest disappearance the city had ever seen. In the coming months and years, detectives, families, reporters, and friends worked as hard as they could to locate the missing 22-year-old. The newspapers put out the word that 5'2", 95 pounds Joanne Williams, with brown hair and blue eyes, had disappeared on the night of Thursday, December 7, 1978. When last seen, she was wearing a black leotard, blue jeans, a beige jacket, flat shoes, and may or may not have been wearing a pair of brown gloves. Years later, Audrey would speak to the media and call into question why Joanne was reported to have brown hair. In the time leading up to her disappearance, she had been dyeing her hair blonde. A color photograph of her taken near the time of her disappearance does show her with hair that is clearly lighter than the brown hair in her senior photo. Shortly after the new year, a combination of law enforcement, Boy Scouts, and civilian volunteers began the first of many searches. A large-scale search of a wooded area near Cathedral Cemetery, close to where her car was found, was conducted, as well as a wide range of surrounding mountains with the help of the Civil Air Patrol. An area by North/South Road from Morgan Highway south to Cathedral Cemetery was searched, but no trace of Joanne was found. Many searches were forced to be called off due to particularly nasty winter weather. Sometime after Joanne's disappearance, William Williams moved out of the house at 513 East Gibson Street, while Joanne's mother Christine stayed. Details of the divorce have been difficult to track down, but William never stopped searching for his daughter. He eventually moved to nearby Dunmore, remarried, and spent countless hours roaming the forests and fields of Lackawanna County, determined to never give up. Perhaps it was the added stress of needing to pack up and move out of his home heaped on top of the already impossible grief from the dissolution of his marriage and the disappearance of his daughter, or perhaps just bad luck. But in the months following Joanne's disappearance, William suffered what his second wife Susan would later tell the newspapers was a small heart attack. On January 23, 1981, William J. Williams died at Mercy Hospital. His brother, Robert Williams, told the Times Tribune that William had undergone open-heart surgery, and a blood clot formed and worked its way up to his heart. "It was just something that happened," he said. Robert, like his brother, wanted to believe that Joanne was still alive. He figured that if she was still out there and able to reach out, her father's death would certainly cause her to at least call. Hope dwindled again as the funeral came and went, and Joanne's absence remained. Robert would continue to cling to hope that his niece was still out there, but her silence after her father's death was extremely discouraging. After William's death, Joanne's mother Christine took up the mantle and asked anyone with tips or leads to bringing them to her.